Thank you. That's pretty amazing thing, actually. And I start with the man in your eyes, for example. We're looking at the height of a falling object as a function of time. Maybe this is a rock, okay? So we're not taking air resistance into account. H is in meters and T is in seconds. H is a function of T. It's 490 meters. That's the height of time, so it's way up there. You're dropping it, letting it fall down. As a function of time, you can have this equation if there is no air resistance. And that is a function whose graph is a parabola. But we're only looking at a limited domain of this function, which does make the function one-to-one over this domain, and it does end up having an inverse function. If you're looking at over a wider domain, it would not have an inverse function. It's a fail that moves on the y axis. And so I talked about that. I talked about solving, for example, for the height in terms of time. For a particular height, how long will it take, for example, to reach 100 meters? This is the height of a function, not time. It's not the distance following the function of time. How long is it going to take to get down to 100 meters? Just need the algebra to solve it to find it's about 8.9 seconds. But then I say, what if we wanted to solve this problem for an arbitrary height? We can do the same steps, but you don't get a number for the answer. You get a function. T equals square root of 490 minus h over 4.9. That, in fact, is the inverse function in this situation. It does represent the answer for all possible values of the height between 0 and 490. Okay, it's a solution to infinite many problems. Now, when you learn about inverse functions in the past, you may have had a teacher or textbook tell you that, in general, you want to swap the variables at the end, like the y and the x around. And you might wonder, why do we do that? Maybe you were told just because we like to have x as the infinite variable. Maybe you were emphasized that if you graph them on the same set of axes, the function of its inverse will have graphs that are reflections of each other across the 45-degree line through the origin. And that's certainly nice and true in that abstract situation, but if your variables mean something, like they do in this case, h is a height in meters and t is time in seconds, you should not swap the variables. I can't emphasize that enough. So that's definitely, you want to keep the t as the dependent variable for the inverse function here, and h is the independent variable. If you want to graph this inverse function, you should not graph it on the same axis, at least if you want to keep the horizontal axis as your independent variable. But you can swap the axes, and that's what I did down here. Okay. Now the fact that the original graph is decreasing in time down is reflecting the fact that the object is falling, and in fact getting faster and faster, and it's falling over time. The fact that the inverse function graph is also decreasing in time down is related to that, but it's harder to understand and explain. Okay, I would challenge you to see if you can figure that out. So that's an example of nonlinear algebra example of inverse functions. I can continue that in this section here, emphasizing the relationship with composition, as I talked about in section 1.8. When you compose a function in its inverse, you get back the original input. So here, the inverse of f of t does equal, well, t in the end, because t is greater than or equal to 0. You should always remember the square root of t squared is actually not equal to t in general, t is the absolute value of t. However, t here is assumed to be greater than or equal to 0, and so therefore the absolute value of t does equal t. If t is actually less than 0, then its absolute value is negative t, which is actually a positive number in that case, but don't worry about that. The computation for f composed of inverse is then here, and we get back the original h, at least if we're not getting a square root of a negative number, then we don't want to imagine numbers in this application, and we're still assuming h is between 0 and 490, because these functions undo each other. The next section is about inverse functions in general. This section is kind of abstract, but it's really, really important. You want to work on understanding abstract things if you don't understand what things are all about in linear algebra. So I got the official definition, first of all, of what it means for a function to be one-to-one or injective. Here, I have talked about one-to-one and non-to in previous sections, but I'm not really giving you an official definition. Here is the definition of one-to-one or injective, and an example. Okay, I would encourage you to work through that. Here is the definition of onto or surjective, and an example as well. You can see it's related to inverse functions that I talk about here. And I talked about restricting a domain or codomain, and that's some of the things you want to pay attention to. And in this section, this is probably the hardest abstract section. But again, it's really important. When your function is one-to-one with an onto, so f has a domain equal to a here, and a codomain equal to b. If it's one-to-one and onto, that's called a bijection, then you can define an inverse function. Now, if it's not one-to-one or onto, you can sometimes restrict the domain or restrict the codomain to make it one-to-one or onto. But don't worry about that here. We are assuming the section of the function is one-to-one or onto. And here's the key thing. Here's how you define the inverse function right here. Given an element, a little b is capital B, left what inverse of little b be the unique element in capital A? That gets mapped to B. Okay, and that's a little confusing if I really think about that. First of all, why is there any element in capital A that gets mapped to B? That's because F is 1-to-1. The fact that F is 1-to-1 means there's some element in capital A that gets mapped to B. And the fact that F is 1-to-1 means it's unique. Okay, and that means you can define it. And because of that, that means that the undoing factor true, this factor here is true, as well as this factor right up here. Okay, now it takes some real careful thought to really understand exactly what I'm saying here. I don't want to take the time to explain it. Okay, I think it's a good exercise for you to really work on understanding. Sometimes drawing pictures, A over here, B over here, and drawing little A, little B back, and thinking back and forth will be helpful here. This is also a couple hard paragraphs here. What I'm trying to emphasize is that function composition first of all is a binary operation, and with respect to this binary operation, inverse functions are kind of like multiplicative inverses of numbers. Okay, I talk about how f inverse of f and f are composed of f inverse give you identity functions just like with non-zero numbers when you multiply a and a inverse. A inverse will be 1 over a or something like that. You get 1, a multiplicative identity for numbers, just like I, a, and I, b are called identity functions or identity mappings. Okay, so this is certainly confusing sometimes, but really make sure you understand before you go on. Now we're getting into linear algebra, and thinking first of all in this section about reminding you about what matrix multiplication is, and that's related to function composition. Here again being the key equation, you want the matrix multiplication to be defined to match the function composition. This section is just review. And based on this review, in order for S and T, when you compose them to have a chance to be inverse functions, the matrix and A meet the inverse matrices, these matrices, these functions, and these domains that come from you have to all have the same dimensions. M, L, and N all have to equal each other in order for there to be a chance for S and T to be inverse functions and for A and B to be inverse matrices, okay? So we're talking, as far as matrices go, square matrices with a number of rows with a number of columns. Before we get into looking at how to calculate the inverse matrix for invertible linear transformation, I do mention here also the basic application that we'll look at in more detail with some examples, that inverse matrices allow you to solve infinitely many problems. T of X equals B for any B, you can solve for X, okay? And if T is invertible, in other words, if A is invertible, that answer is going to be A inverse times B. That's the use of inverse matrices. You can find the formula for A inverse multiplied times an arbitrary B, you have solved this equation for any arbitrary B. A just can't keep the zero, the number zero, and the inverse function is this thing right here. And in terms of matrices, you can write it this way, and you can compose these functions to become the inverse function. And like I said, if A is zero, this is not invertible, and A is invertible, when A is non-zero, that's the main thing to get out of here. All right, what about inverse matrix of a linear transformation from R2 itself? This is more important section in terms of generally what happens in linear algebra. And this section is pretty nice. We can come up with a nice formula for inverse. But I'll tell you how to derive that formula in a way that is going to be useful in generalized higher dimensions. So we can define, so if A is this vector matrix representing the linear transformation T, we can define the formula for A inverse if it exists. Okay? And I talk about this equation being one of certainly obviously true, where this thing is called the 2x2 identity matrix. We have one of them, one of them being diagonal as well as this one. And I talk about the properties of the identity matrix here related to inverse transformations of the matrices. And the key equation you want to use to solve the inverse matrix in this key equation right here, you want A times A inverse, and also A inverse times A equal I to the 2x2 identity matrix right there.
Because if you go to this rational form, the left here does not indicate any matrix here.
this theorem seems to be the case, but I'm not proving this theorem. Oh, that's the general algorithm for finding inverse matrix. The reducible echelon form of the arc matrices, the double strip of the triple arc matrices, is what you generalize to find A inverse. So there's three issues to consider. If T is a variable, what is the default? If T inverse really is a linear transformation, I really assume that earlier. How is A inverse set? And is there a determining condition? Yes, there is a determining condition. We'll look at that in a little bit more detail in the next section. For one, the answer is yes, it would be linear, but verifying that against all of this. It's trivial, you might think. You need to use the linear condition, which I've also called the operation preserving condition. You need to prove this equation is true. For A, the arbitrary scalars, you need arbitrary vectors. And you need to use the fact that T and T inverse do each other. And T is 1 to 1, okay? And the line reasoning is what you see here. This equation comes from the fact that T and T inverse undo each other. This line right here represents the first quality is the fact that T is assumed to be operation preserving condition linear. And the second quality comes from the fact that T and T inverse undo each other both respond. And what we have here then is that this equation is true and this equation is true, and most of the right-hand sides are the same here. Both for this equals this, which I stayed out there. And now the fact that T is 1 to 1 implies that their inputs must be the same. When you've got a 1 to 1 function, when the outputs are the same, the inputs must be the same. That's the final equation, which is exactly what we're proving. That's an abstract proof that the inverse function, which will exist when the function is 1 to 1 to, is in fact linear. It's operation preserving, which again, I was assuming really. Here's the algorithm in general for finding the inverse matrix. You form your block augmented matrix, where the thing on the left is A and the thing on the right is IN, where N is an arbitrary block manager. And you go to the reducible echelon form. If the block form the result is in this form, then A is the variable and the inverse matrix would be the matrix on the right, or form B here. If in fact the block form contains a row of zeros and zeros in the first N column somewhere, so one of the rows in those first N columns is all zeros, those mean that the numbers on the right side are zero, the last N columns, then A is going to be not equal. If you can't get an IN here to the left, that's what I'm trying to say. This method is justified ultimately by the same kind of reasoning with those special cases. Finally, here's our visual example. We're talking about a rotation 90 degrees counterclockwise around the origin. Here's its matrix. Its inverse matrix evidently would represent a rotation clockwise 90 degrees around the origin. It should make intuitive sense that those kinds of operations will undo each other. In fact, that is the case. And here's your visual. You've got the original set here, the butterfly curve. That's in red. That's A, which is our inverse of R of A. The blue set there is the image of R of A. The pink set, the red one, is also the image of the blue set. Transformation, that's what I'm trying to say. In answer, this also is a 270-degree counterclockwise rotation, but that's less natural.